really major change was this area here. It kind of bumped out about 15 feet. And what it did, it changed the buffer zones, 25-foot and a 35-foot buffer zone here. So in doing so, we had to revise these two lots as part of the design. I'll get back to it later. One of the first things we did, and conservation was kind of asking for it, was reduce the width of the roadway pavement. Originally, we had 30 feet here. We are now proposing 26. We reduced the size by 4 feet. We kept the layout the same, 60-foot layout. The sidewalks in the same location, but we have less impervious area now and more green space in between the layout. The cul-de-sac staying the same size, the shape, the radius, to allow emergency vehicles to access the in and out. So this did not change. You can make a maneuver here and back out again. That was one thing we did not change. And I did, I think, Julie, my head out, we compared other towns what they require for roadway width, pavement width. And the reason we question this is it's such a short length of roadway. It's 3 feet, it's not a through street. To a dead end street. So we looked at other towns and typically 24 to 26 and 28 were the width they had. So we're asking for a waiver of the required width of 30 feet to 26 feet in pavement. In addition, on the existing conditions plan, we added additional test holes out there for the site. We had test holes for the drainage basin here, infiltration here. This is something DEP asked us to do. We performed those last week. That data was added to the plans and submitted to the Conservation Commission. And lots 4 and 5, as we spoke about earlier, because of the change in wetland lanes and buffer zone changes, we reconfigured lot 4. We kind of pushed it forward a little bit. Here, the bigger backyard, we put a patio deck more centered than the house. On lot 5, originally had an addition here, going out another 10 more feet. We cut that back. We're about 9 feet from the existing house with the small addition here to the stone wall, which separates the, I guess, the wetland buffer zone in between the house. And also, we cut back this driveway a little bit too, also, pulled it out of the buffer zone and put an infiltration basin, I guess, drainage area in the back here. Conservation has reviewed this at the time. They seem satisfied with our changes there because we complied with the setbacks and the local zoning bylaw. We submitted mountain cows that were required by DEP and also to the Conservation Commission. That basically does just determine the during a 100-year flood storm and high groundwater, any breakout from water from the drainage basins here. Here. We satisfy DEP and Conservation Commission with those calculations. We have submitted information back in February to the Reading Municipal Light Department. I've talked to them several times. We haven't heard back from them yet. In confirmation of the layout of the utility plans, where they want the lighting, the electrical, so we're kind of waiting on that at this point. The road name, we actually have a road name now. It's not in a plan that was submitted to you. We was it last week or you met with them? Yeah. The road name.
2 weeks ago?
2 weeks ago, yeah. When I submitted the plans, we resubmitted them and signed them prior before doing the plan. It's proposed road name is Veterans Way now, and that was approved by the Veterans Group.
Yep.
Okay. So those will be added to the plan next time we submit them for revisions. And also, the attorney has been working on the language for the easement here, and also the language for the conservation trail and restrictions, and also the language for the sewer pump stations. Each individual house has their own E1 pump. Here, everyone has it. That's down here. This is gravity release pump. So he's working that language. We hope to have it. We're hoping to have it conditioned as prior to any start of any work out there. That we condition that it's to the satisfaction of this board. We also submitted to engineering. They asked for a traffic analysis And we submitted the, I don't know if you have the plans, Julie.
I have the, yeah.
Instead of a traffic report, you asked for a traffic analysis, and we, this is, sent a memo to him.
Did you want the plan?
Yeah, the plan too. His concern was, some of the site distance, as you leave, people who grow up this way, up Main Street. So we did analysis here, and it's based on ASHTO and Mass Highways, specifications and their design requirements. And we do meet the distance, 350 feet is a minimum site distance, like this right hand to make left-hand turn. We actually meet that here, and left-hand turn, 385 is a minimum. We have a 600-foot, I guess, viewing range out to the left. So we satisfied the ASHTO requirements, and this was submitted to engineering, and they reviewed it. I don't think they did a comment on it, so I assume they're satisfied with that.
Does that account for grade?
Yes, yeah, so the profile here, yeah, we did both. So site distance in blue here is profile. So here's a profile of Main Street. It drops down here, and requirements here, that's the oncoming car. You take an average of about 3.5 feet above the profile, the site distance, and it does clear that site distance to here where the proposed car is. So we did provide that to engineering. And here are the requirements for an ASHTO and Mass Highway we use in our calculation. We provided a memo also explaining it to them, how it worked. And I think that's it. That's basically the changes and the additional information we submitted to the engineering and CBDC. So if you have any questions for you at this time.
With the reduced width,
yeah.
Do you have a wide enough mouth to get the cars off of 28 fast enough?
Yeah,
or whatever it is.
Sure. No, which one do you want me to go to?
I guess the rendering plane is fine.
Or I'll zoom in a little bit.
That's fine.
Okay.
For us, like Mass DOT, we still need a curb cut permit. So they're going to approve the widths and the radiuses. And we commonly have 24 radiuses if you have like industrial, like Calusos. We work on that. That's 24 feet wide coming out of there. So this meets, and that's much more traffic. This meets the minimum width that we require. And 30-foot radius here is the minimum they require. So we meet the radiuses and the widths coming in from Mass DOT. They still need to see this and approve this opening themselves. If they're not satisfied with it, we'd have to come back here with a redesign. So we design to make sure that they'll be, you know, they know, we know what they expect, and we design it based on their criteria.
What would they require differently? A wider opening, a larger radius?
Maybe a larger radius.
Yeah.
So then that would just taper back into the 26 foot at some point further up.
Further here, right?
Yeah.
But they have a minimum. They don't like them too big. They don't like the big wide openings. So, and actually, 24 feet, 30 foot radiuses.
The 30 foot radius is what was that one up at the ice cream place that when they were going to repave and Dandelions. When they didn't end up doing it, but they were trying to enforce a 30-foot radius on that,
right.
And it didn't quite work. But that's consistent with what we've seen at other locations along here that MassDOT has required. So,
right.
I guess my concern on this is that the site distance calculation. So the distances used are, you know, in the from the MassDOT design guideline,
right.
Is flat ground. So you did the profile so
right.
That you saw, you know, 3 feet up, you can see over the crest.
Right.
But the distances, depending on what the grade is may change. There's even a note in there that you're supposed to go back to the green book and recalculate that. I think that MassDOT's standards are actually a little bit more stringent than, it's not, they're not standards, it's guidelines.
Right.
Our guidelines are a little bit more stringent than what's in the green book, but it's unclear. I don't know what the grade is there. I couldn't go back and recalculate it. I didn't know what the grade is. And because you're right there between 445 and 450.
Right.
And, you know, it's how high is that crest and where, I mean, you're right at that edge of being within MassDOT's guidelines. And I think that's what we had heard before, is that that's a concern. That one,
it's in here.
Cars coming there, a car turning out heading north,
right,
slowly, and
this
and
here, right?
Yeah, and a car coming up onto it.
Yes, it was very close. And,
yeah.
I mean, I know we sent it to engineering, and so he can check and scale it.
Yeah, and with them not responding, or they're right, we got no feedback from them on that particular aspect, right? I mean, that's, I didn't see any, and you didn't get any.
No, they didn't comment.
Yeah. I don't know what the solution for that is. I guess that's the other thing,
mm-hmm,
is what is the solution from that? I mean, the solution, which I don't like, is a stoplight. Mm. You know, I mean, that's really the,
you just
that's
the last piece of that road further down.
I mean, if you didn't meet that, you know, if everything was tighter,
right,
that's what you'd end up having to do.
Is moving this road up.
Is either moving the road up,
yeah,
or putting in a stoplight that's, you know, that's actuated by a car sitting there.
Right.
I don't think either of them really work.
Why would you move it that way? Why would you move it further away from the? Don't you need more sight distance?
Well, if you move it up the hill, if you move it up the hill, then you'd be able to see further.
Yeah, I don't think you're gonna pick up that much grade.
I don't know.
So it's traffic coming this way.
Yeah.
It's this maneuver here, and yeah, right. You can, it's head pitches. You can see up the way. It's really tight how to get, you know, by there, and it's based on design speed. And you know, if someone's going 65 miles an hour, it's gonna be a problem.
It's gonna be a problem. Yeah.
Right, but it's like that. Be the same here too. Mass DOT is gonna take a look at this, and we gotta satisfy them too.
So I guess I'm jumping a little bit ahead, but I did see in engineering's memo that they would like to see, before you start construction in the right of way, in MassDOT's right of way, which you have to anyways, that permit. I guess I'd like to see you get that permit before you start. Period, because if they need you to do something different with that roadway, I don't want to see you start construction on part of it and then have to redo the.
Totally agree. That's right, because that if we start construction and they say no to this, then we're gonna stop. So I agree.
Right.
We need to get the Mass DOT approval before they even start any construction on there itself.
Right.
Well, the remedy also might be a flashing signal on Main Street and or speed limit modification for that stretch of road.
DOT gets to do that.
Yeah.
Right.
Not us.
Yeah. In a speed limit modification, I mean, to me, that's a little bit, I mean, I don't know how many, what the ADT is on that road on Main Street there, but for the 20 movements that are going to come out for everyone, for the thousands to slow down for those couple, seems disproportionate.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to simply, they won't give us an answer until they say, well, has the planning board approved it yet? And then they won't look at it, and then they'll look at it, and then if they make changes, then we got to come back here and reopen it. It's kind of, you know,
chicken and egg.
So they will look at this plan. They'll probably go out on the site with us. We'll see, and they'll ask the same questions you're asking here. So, I mean, we hope they'll be back before you, but if they're not happy with this, we'll be back.
Okay, so let's say they make you move the driveway opening north. Is that first lot on the right there? Do you, no, the other one.
Oh, sorry.
If you move it north, right? The north arrow is towards you.
Right.
You shouldn't have a compass as your logo. Put it on a spine. If you have to move that driveway north so that, you know, sort of bends into the roadway,
right,
do you still have enough upland on that lot right there?
You probably would have to swing the roadway kind of like that a little bit.
But does that lot still comply with the upland requirements?
We'd probably lose the house. If I, the lot, we'd have to refigure the numbers around.
Okay.
You know, it's, you can tell, but the house would have to go, the existing house. So we kind of got centered there, so the lots work out well, and I think we moved it. Chance, because the wetland does bump out here now.
Yeah, you lost 15 feet on that side, you might lose that lot.
Yeah.
So everyone keep that in mind.
I think the only way it would help, we'd move it up, because...
Okay, so that you move up the hill,
right,
so you see it a little
bit
further.
Maybe 50 feet here, but elevation-wise, you bump up. You know, and you could lift the roadway coming down, but...
Then you've got,
We're kind of waiting to see what they say. You know, they...
Because you're right. Point is, you're right at that cusp.
Right.
Where, you know, it may work.
It's this one here. It's right.
Yes.
Here.
Yeah. I guess, from my point of view, I can't believe I'm going to say this, but if MassDOT's happy, I'm happy. With, you know, if they approve it, then it's. It's their highway. You know, it's their,
right.
They're more in tune with this than we are. So I feel good. I mean, I feel good in the sense that they're going to give it a thorough review and make sure it works.
Do you still want that approval, like prior to endorsement or prior to?
Prior to construction. Prior to commencing
construction. Yeah.
Okay.
I think he wants it too. So I think that shouldn't be a.
Take them weeks before.
So prior to commencement of
site
work.
Okay.
Because they'll have to, if he loses the lot, he's going to have to come back.
Right.
Change the
game.
Karen's not here, but she did send an email with some comments, mostly related to the traffic on that. It says it's a long stretch of Main Street that is on a steep grade, making sight lines very difficult. Traffic on this stretch travels very fast. We already have three difficult and dangerous intersections on this side of Main Street, including two sections of Pearl Street and Franklin Street. Adding another roadway to this area of Main Street will not improve anything, only make it worse, even with the low traffic suggested by the developer. Personally, I believe this development is adding another potentially fatal hazard, a fact echoed in the previous public comments. So she would have voted no, but cannot proxy vote. So those were her comments, and I think all of us are saying that if DOT looks at it and says it's okay.
Well, where are we process-wise with this?
And it looked like they had provided all the information. Engineering was okay with everything they had commented on. Traffic. Conservation said they were, wait, am I mixing these up now? Conservation said that they hadn't finalized anything yet, but that they didn't see any obstacles to approving it when they received the final packet.
They just wanted a little more time to review the information, but they are anticipating closing the hearing on the 26th.
If they received it the night before or the
night of. Yeah, something like that.
They didn't have time to review it, but they didn't see anything.
Yeah.
Well, the reason I ask is, I mean, we have the note from engineering, the April 12th, which is still asking for the 30-foot pavement width. And that's sort of like up in the air as far as...
Well, they also want sidewalks on both sides.
Yeah.
I didn't get a chance to talk to Ryan this week because he's out this week, and he sent me the memo when I was out last week. So it's your call, but that's something that he asks for with every project because it's in the subdivision regulations. We have a different philosophy on pavement, so.
I guess I feel comfortable that this is consistent with other similar subdivisions where, you know, we try and keep the pavement narrow. It's, you know, it's only a couple of houses. I'm not sure you really need all that much pavement space, and with just the sidewalk on one side. There's been a number that we've approved that seems to make sense. My question, if I can
sure.
interrupt you,
sure.
is how does this all play in with our complete streets policies in terms of pavement widths and sidewalks on things like this? Have we thought about that at all?
They're providing a sidewalk on one side, which is something. I mean, they're not providing bike lanes, but bike lanes to nowhere, bike lanes to Main Street.
Yeah, it's because
it's
stubs onto Main Street. I mean, there's sort of a damned if you do, damned if you don't.
You know, if we update the subdivision regulations at some point, maybe we could make the regulations more in line with complete streets so that we're consistent with every project.
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure that we thought about that. That's our policy.
So it's also recommended by conservation. They wanted the reduced width as well.
Yeah. Just say, well, you know, originally we had to make sidewalks both sides, and we had 30 pavement. The feedback from them was like, you reduce the amount of impervious area, so we're just adding some with the sidewalks to both sides. So then we went back and redesigned it with the less pavement and sidewalks. So it is a reduction in impervious area, which we think is good for the environment. At the same time, it's cheaper to construct it.
Well, it's certainly better in this locus because of the the large wetland area to the north of the project. I mean, so it's okay.
No problem.
Okay. Any public comments? So you've had a chance to look at this decision?
I did, yeah.
We're going to add the condition that prior to commencing work, you'll have the approval from Mass DOT. Julie, do you notice that it says under waivers that it says okay with engineering? Oh, that's a question. These are all question marks, aren't they? For the travel way.
Which page is that?
Page 4, number 7. But there, actually, you were asking the question.
Yeah. Because I wrote this before he wrote his memo.
It's fine.
That's why.
What about number 6? It seems like every development that's coming in now is showing less and less of the stuff that's in the regs, which means that we're collecting less and less information.
Right, that's accurate. I think to some degree that's an indication that the regs are a little outdated. But you're totally within your rights to push back on that and ask for that information to be provided.
When I look at the GIS maps, it looks like there's a lot of topography in there already.
Right.
So I'm wondering where that data is coming from. Have we already surveyed everything?
No, that's coming from the state. This is the Mass GIS.
Okay.
It's a topography layer, yeah.
And so do we go in and then supplement it when we get development information?
That's a good question. I know we do it for like wetlands delineations. We have a Redding wetlands layer. I don't think we update our local our state topography with local topography, but I can ask Ryan and our GIS person.
It'd just be good to know going forward if we should be asking for that, like
okay.
Not allowing this kind of a waiver.
Can ask.
Do we have to vote on each waiver individually, or can we do them all?
We could do them together if you think that the...
Do them all at once?
I don't.
I get free legal advice.
I think that we can do them as a bunch.
Yep.
And if somebody complains, then we'll find out otherwise.
Okay.
Under the conditions on page 5, we've got the engineering comments. Perhaps we should add resolve things or waived something. I'm not sure because a couple of them from the memo are covered in the waivers. We're looking to engineering would be happier with 30 feet, but we're going to give them the waiver for that. And they'd be happier for sidewalk on both sides, but we're going to waive that.
Well, I don't think it would be considered an outstanding comment at that point because you guys are the permit granting authority, so you're making that decision. It would just be not really.
They would have to deal with any comments that weren't part of the waiver.
That hadn't been dealt with in some way or another.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, that does remind me one more comment. Do you have the utility plan? Right now you're showing all of the grinder pumps and manholes coming right out of the front of every single house. And there's gonna be a stoop there probably. And then you're not gonna have the big manhole, you're not gonna have the grinder pump cover
right in front of there.
So if you have to start shifting those, you know, right now they're just sort of hitting onto the street.
Is it this one?
Yeah, it's fine.
Sure. If you zoom in, you'll see it.
I mean, we just boxes, so we're trying to ask. We just picked the center house. Each house will probably be laid out differently. So this may move. You're right. It may not be that exact spot, but our intent was just to show an image the way it was coming out of the front of the house. And it won't go through garages. You know, we don't want to come into the garage floor on the stoops. We'll try to, you know, basically with how it's designed, where the plumbing's coming out of the house, we'll move it accordingly.
Okay, and the design pieces that you have in your drawings, they're flexible enough for that, where if you start having grade changes or if you have to do angles?
Yeah, we'll do individual plot plans. Once we get a house, we're going to build, we'll do a plot plan that shows the gradings and grade particular associated with that house, where the sewer and water line comes in, make sure those have right cover and the pitches and everything. This is more just a schematic, give an idea, you know, make sure the boxes fit, they conform the zoning, and basically the utilities work. So yeah, we'll be more into the plot plans for a building permit. They'll be more specific about where those might be exactly. And the boxes may have, you know, the bay windows, you know, little jogs here. So they'll fit with inside pretty much for the most part, these boxes here.
Okay.
Okay, do we want a condition about basically the as-built plans basically for the utilities, which are specific to the new properties, we want to make sure that the town gets the appropriate plan update.
There is a condition about as-built plans.
Okay.
It's on, let's see.
Page eight.
Page eight, under prior to issuance of certificate of completion.
Okay.
Also, they don't release any outstanding bond until they get that, so.
Anything else? I don't see anything else.
I'm all set.
Move that the CPDC approve the definitive subdivision plan for 1260 and 1264 Main Street, Mass Equity Investments LLC, as amended.
Including all waivers?
Including the waivers as updated on page four.
Second.
All in favor? Okay.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Thank you.
And I'll finalize this in Sunday. Well, you can put that on the endorsement. Yeah.
Thank you.
Sure.
Okay, next up is a continued public hearing for 364 Lowell Street, Lyle Estates. Lowell Street.
Good evening, my name's Thad Berry from ASB Design Group. Just wanted to kind of fill you in from when we last met. Since our last meeting, we have worked with Conservation Commission to get approval and have an order of conditions issued for the project. And the appeal period for that order of conditions is expired. So we're okay with the Conservation Commission as far as approvals. Since then, we've also incorporated into the plans the comments raised from the engineering department. Those were all addressed individually through our response letter and then incorporated into the plan. We didn't have any problems with their comments and their requests. So tonight, at this point, we don't really have a draft decision. We're looking for input and hopefully a vote tonight to close and hopefully move on with approval.
Okay, Julie, do you want to go through the comments or do you want to talk about engineering's memo?
Which comments?
It looked like there was a long list of responses. Is that this one? Am I mixing up all my forms?
From
the applicant.
Maybe. Let's see.
that the other one?
Sorry.
I think that was the other one.
Okay.
Oh, it could have been the response to comments that you're talking about, like their response to the engineering's comments of this one.
Yeah, those are all closed out, right?
Yeah, and we have a new memo from engineering basically saying that they've, you know, satisfied their outstanding concerns.
Okay. What else do we have? Anything else left open? There are some of the, have you seen the decision, by the way?
I have. I just have a couple of comments. This is in particular findings numbers 9 and 10 on page 4. In the initial plan, the owners had thought about and like the idea of changing the address from Lowell Street to the new way, but that would have created a front setback problem, which would have required us to go to Zoning Board of Appeals to satisfy. So upon reflection, they would prefer to just keep the front door on Lowell Street, and therefore we don't have to worry about 20-foot setback for the what would be the side door now, the side of the house on the new way. And we don't have to worry about that same problem with regard to the garage that they plan to build on there. So
that's, let me just make sure, that's this one right here. That's this house right here, right?
Yes, that's the existing, house. So that, I think there's about 35 feet from Lowell Street or more. And then there's more than 15 feet from the side of the house on the new way. So you wouldn't have to worry about Zoning Board of Appeals on those two issues.
So they'll keep it fronting on, or
well,
they'll keep it facing Lowell with the address on Lowell?
The address is not going to change from 364 Lowell Street. The front door will be on Lowell Street.
Okay.
Another, I think it was already addressed, but under conditions, number 2, with regard to paper streets, I had provided a letter to engineering, I think it was March 11th, and that is referenced as number 32 in your materials pack. And that just explained why there is not a problem with regard to the old paper streets.
They were extinguished a long time ago, according
well,
to
well, in essence, they were never really there because it was a plan. The original plan goes back to about 1899. There was another plan drawn in 1925. This is the last remaining parcel from that huge plot of land up there, and houses were built on Dustin Road, which are sitting on top of those old quote-unquote paper streets. But those plans were never approved. In fact, it's stated right on the plan from 1925, not approved. It's just for reference purposes. So, and by virtue of the fact that the current owners and the prior owners purchased the property from a successor entitled to the original developer,
There's certainly no...
They're just dash lines on a piece of paper, effectively.
Yes. Certainly no recorded easements.
Exactly.
So that will strike that one. Hmm. I should have taken it out. I just missed it.
I actually met with Ryan, went through it with him, and he did not note that on his last memo, so I think that's why I was bringing it to your attention. I think, so on page 6, I've got prior to plan endorsement heading. Again, number 1 deals with the variances, so you won't have to worry about that. I'd like to ask for some clarification on number 12 under that same prior to plan endorsement section, under the covenant agreement. Near, just before the italicized language, there's a sentence that says, no partial release of the lots from this covenant shall be allowed. I hope that doesn't mean that we're not going to be able to convey out houses as they are finished and built.
It does not mean that. I'm not actually sure what it means, but there is a process for having lots individually released.
But it says that they can't be. That's what troubles me.
This is directly from the subdivision regulations, this language.
Mm-hmm.
So I will have to look at that,
okay.
What that specifically means, but it does not mean that you can't have individual lots released either, you know, at the time that you construct the house and convey the property.
Right.
It does not mean that.
As we are not prohibited from selling before the last house is completed and everything is signed off on, because that just wouldn't be...
Right, no, that's
okay.
That's not correct.
All right, thank you.
So...
There's language beyond that, though, that should say that you can't sell anything until all the easements and utilities are conveyed.
That's a condition.
Right. That's,
right.
Again, that's language.
Right,
in
and that's result. Very that's very important.
Yeah, and that I'm fine with that. I'll be working that once we're satisfied here with the overall plan. I will start to work on the easements and the conveyance language, and I'll submit that to Julie. We can run it by town council. There are certain easements which we'll have to take care of, including the tree planting easement. So I've got some work to do, but we'll be able to get that done in fairly short order. I think that was it. Thank you.
Conservation is all set with how you plan to clean up the area, get in there and clean it. Okay. Are you using manual or equipment?
It'll be a combination of both.
Okay. The edits that I have are to change it to Lowell Street in the title on page one. David pointed that out.
Where is that? Sorry.
The title under decision of approval, it says Lowell Road.
Oh, sorry. I look at it so much, I don't see those things anymore.
I didn't even see that
either. We're gonna
I used to work off of a Lowell Road, now I work off of a Lowell Street. It's very confusing.
There are several sections where it's asking for little dates of memos.
Right. Yeah, so that's engineering memo.
Engineering.
April 13th, so I'll just add that in.
Okay, that's on 5 and 6 and
it's
8.
It's on 3, yeah, as well.
It's one on 3, yeah.
Yep.
35,
there's 2.
Yep.
And then there are the... findings 8 and 9. So finding 8, I guess it should just say all lots are proposed to be developed to meet the setbacks, or do you just want to eliminate the finding? I think you should leave it because there's a history of discussion from before that.
Well, those are the ones that are going to have new homes. Lot 1 will have an existing home that will meet the setback requirements since they keep it.
Okay, so then for 9, you'll have to, what, strike the second half of that sentence? The applicant is proposing to maintain the existing house in its location and strike the whole rest of that.
Yep, right.
Okay. Well, I guess I should take public comments. Any public comments on this?
Tony Durazzo, 130 John Street. For the existing building, what is the sidewalk setback to the new road?
11 point something feet, according to the diagram.
I thought it was more than 15. I thought it was more than 15. Talking about the first lot.
The one with the existing house, remaining on Wall Street.
Isn't that more than 15 feet?
It's the existing, it's less.
Let me just go to the plan that shows actually the existing and proposed.
Yeah, on the lotting plan, C4, it's 11.7 feet from the right-of-way, which is the 40-foot.
Okay, then I apologize. I stand corrected. I thought that was more than 15 feet, so it's a pre-existing non-conforming, although with a new road in. We'll take it to the Zoning Board of Appeals.
Wait a second.
We can't move the house back and can't move the road over.
Super hard to see on this plan. Can you just go over that again? What is the discrepancy?
Well, they have a side yard setback that doesn't meet zoning.
Oh, yeah. Right.
Can you zoom in on that a little more?
Well, yeah, it's the sheet four of, or sheet four of 11 of the original plan shows it with the dimensions.
7.5 feet.
What is it?
Right here, it's 7.5.
So then the question is, if you're going to go to the zoning board for a variance, yeah, are you just going to change the address?
Right.
Okay, I'm confused.
Why makes sense just to try to change the address?
Well, this house is existing?
They're increasing the non-conformity.
Yes.
And then is this, no, this is existing.
That's the existing.
This is the garage. Okay, right, yeah. So if you put a new garage in and you don't meet the setback, then yeah.
Right, exactly.
You'll get a variance. Or you'll seek a variance.
You'll seek a variance.
You'll hope to get a variance.
Exactly.
I don't know.
Right.
So you're proposing to add on to that house?
Yes, a garage. So you can leave that one in, I guess.
Okay, so we'll.
So this is back to here. I don't know why.
You moved that one.
He's good for that.
That's the 11-foot dimension.
Right, but they're proposing to add on to that, so they'll increase that non-conformance. So I guess we should really make sure that finding is worded properly.
Right, so it's number 10 that talks about the garage.
Right, but a few minutes ago we decided it wasn't the front yard setback.
Well, so it depends. I mean, the garage will need a variance regardless because it wouldn't meet front or side.
Right.
So we could just say it will infringe on the setback.
The setback.
And then they can decide whether they...
Whether it's side or front. Either way, it doesn't comport with the standards. So. Mm-hmm. So you can just strike the 20 foot in front.
Then what about with number 9? To Nick's question, if you go for a variance, will you just also make the address off of the new road at the same time?
Again, the initial intention was to have the address of Lyle Estates,
right,
whatever number that might have been. You know what, leave them both in. Mm-hmm. Just leave them both in. And at this point, we're going before the ZBA anyway.
Yeah.
So we'll just go back to what their initial intention was.
It makes for a safer condition, I think, that way anyway.
Yeah.
Sorry for the confusion.
That's okay. I mean, they're likely to grant that, likely to grant that. So then, if, sorry, if they grant that, it gives you more flexibility to have it as the front street.
And then we'll add that. On page six, we'll add back in number one under prior to plan endorsement.
Yes.
Yeah, I think we did the procedure last time incorrectly. We didn't close the public hearing before we voted. So we need to make sure to close this public hearing before we vote on the site plan.
Move that we close the public hearing for the definitive subdivision plan of 364 Lowell Street.
Second. All in favor?
Move that the CPDC approve the definitive subdivision plan for 364 Lowell Street, Jameson Properties LLC, as amended.
Second.
I just add a friendly amendment to that.
And what about the waivers?
Asking about the waivers, yeah. We either vote on the waivers. The way the decision is written, it looks like you vote on the waivers and vote on the whole thing. But if you want to just say it includes all the waivers, that's fine as well.
Do them together,
yeah.
Too, it's
fine. Including the waivers.
Thank you.
I'll second that as well.
All in favor?
Thank you.
Thank you. Good luck.
I'll look into that thing for you. Ryan's out of town this week, but we won't make this unnecessarily difficult. That's not the intent.
Alright. Good.
Alright, guys. Thank you, Tony.
Move that we close the public hearing for the definitive subdivision plan of Mass Equity Investments 1260 and 1264 Main Street.
Second. All in favor?
Make sure that we don't leave it open forever.
Keep coming back to it.
I would have like had realized when I wrote the minutes probably and then been like, yeah, they
closed it. All right, adoption. Next up is adoption of commission regulations for stormwater management and erosion control.
So, town council provided some feedback on the application that I put together, and then they also prepared regulations, which I wasn't exactly sure that that was needed, but I guess it is. So you have a separate document that you've never seen before. As of yesterday. So I don't know if you want to take action on both of them or one of them or neither and just look at them tonight and discuss them.
Let's just take a look at the stormwater bylaw changes first because they don't look that extensive.
It's not the bylaw.
It's the
for clarity's sake, for people watching this on TV.
I'm sorry, say that again?
They're not bylaw changes. There's regulations and there's an application.
Okay.
So
So we saw the application before, which we were using as a proxy for our process.
Right, exactly.
And town council basically said, without really saying it, said, yeah, that's all well and fine, but you actually need regulations.
Right, and then they gave us these regulations, which they've developed for other towns that they provide counsel to, so, and a lot of the language in them comes directly from, I guess, the bylaw, and the MS4 permit, I believe. The requirements of MGL chapter 4453G and 4453G and a half, which is actually the outside consultant. That's not the MS4 permit, but let me just see.
When I read through this, it's like I've seen it all before in
okay.
some other format, aside from the couple of comments on the fee and the consultant support. But I think we've seen 95% of this in some other way, shape, or form.
Is it similar to the bylaw? I didn't really get a chance to look at it in great detail.
Yeah, I mean, it lifts, it's...
I didn't... It's because she suggests in her email that not only do we give them this application, we give them a copy of the bylaw and this. I just feel like...
I thought we were trying to simplify.
Right, yeah.
You know, I don't know. So.
We can hand the lawyer this.
So if the regulations are more or less like lifted out of the bylaw, then.
See, administratively though, I mean, the stormwater management is a general bylaw enforced by the CPDC.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Which is why that we need these extra things.
Is that why we need these extra things?
Yeah. My understanding is.
Is why we need the regulations, you think?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll take your word for it. I wasn't sure, so it sounds good.
Because, well, it's basically the regulation is the how we intend to enforce the general bylaw, because the bylaw says that we are enforcing it.
Because there's no other
right.
There's no other structure around those regulations where
yeah.
this, at least it, we have the definitions and the fees and
right.
then the bulk of the bylaw in here. And then our process.
What about his comments to change Public Services Department to Planning Division or CPDC or Community Development Director?
I mean, it doesn't.
Let's see.
Somebody comes in looking for the Public Services Department, are they going to find the right person?
Yeah, I mean. I'm just thinking about, like, the future, right? Because, like, right now, I mean, whatever you want to call it, I'm going to get it and we'll figure it out. But, like, in the future, does it make sense if I'm not here, like, for clarity's sake, should it be? Yeah, I mean, maybe it makes sense to have it be Community Development Director so they know the specific person when they come in. Or in case the title changes, if we put it as Planning Division, that's a little more, I don't know.
If it says CPDC, who do they go to?
Well, we wouldn't say that.
Okay.
I don't think.
So then planning division is the biggest umbrella.
That's the best.
Is there a position, community development director?
That's me.
Okay.
Yeah.
Forgive me for not knowing that.
That's okay, I'm not sweating that one.
I think something a little more specific than public services department, so either community development director or planning division is fine.
Yeah, okay, planning, I think planning division maybe, just in case like titles change or whatever, or like maybe there's a gap in.
Yeah.
Between employment or whatever, I'm not going anywhere.
Do we call it planning division or do we call it planning department?
Division.
Okay.
Well, I mean, you could put your lawyer hat on and say, deliver to community development director or other designated.
I leave that hat at home.
Okay.
We have enough lawyers involved here.
Now, what about these fees? Is the fee schedule yours?
Mm-mm.
It's theirs.
Yep.
Do you think these are reasonable? I have no idea really what a reasonable fee would for this would be.
Let's take a quick look.
Oh, did you get Appendix A? Oh, wait,
yep.
Hold on.
For a site plan review for say a relatively simple project, which I'm not sure I can point to what one that would be. Fees in general that we collect?
I believe it's $12 per thousand cost of construction.
Yeah, bear in mind that the stormwater doesn't kick in until you're talking about an acre or more.
Right.
So this is not a typical S20 kind of lot. I mean, this is.
Right, no, yeah. The average single family home is not going to have to do this in this town. And it's an acre of disturbance too, so
right.
It's not just like an acre of a lot.
Okay, but it could be a single family home on a 2-acre lot.
Yes, if they are, oh goodness, that's just horrible to think about.
They're building on top of a hill.
Isn't it horrible?
That they would disturb an acre to build a single
oh.
family home.
Sad. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's not bad to have a house on a 2-acre lot.
I mean, if I could see if in a town where if they had to put in like a septic system and a, you know, maybe, but.
Or if you had to bulldoze 4 acres
maybe.
To make room for your house.
You got to get rid of all those historic structures in front of it so you can get knock some back. Okay. 12 per thousand.
The reality is how many times are we gonna really even use this?
I don't know.
Right.
That's really the
even the project, the Reading Village project is just under an acre.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, if you want to get a mental handle on it, just think about, we have, what, 26 acres at Redding Woods?
Is that right?
Yeah. So that would clearly fall into this category. And that would have been 500 plus 200 times 26, which is another usurious amount for a project that large.
No, right. General, you know what, this might help us to encourage developers to disturb less land. If possible.
Unless the neighbors require it, yeah.
I mean, if they can disturb less than an acre, if they're close to that threshold and they can disturb less than an acre, they also avoid the NPD's permit, which is kind of like a pain in the butt.
Okay. Public comments?
Tony Durazzo, 130 John Street. Mr. Chairman, the two projects that came up before the board earlier today, would they have been subject to the stormwater plan?
They were filed before we had the stormwater bylaw.
In theory?
In theory, yes, they both would have.
So that gives you an idea on which type of project actually would be hit.
Yeah, it's still reasonable.
It's still only $500 plus 200 per acre.
Yeah.
Right, so it's not 500 per residence. It's $500 plus 200 per acre. And what was that? Five? No, that wasn't 5 acres.
It's like four something.
Yeah, I mean, it's not unreasonable for development undertaking that thing. They're doing more dealing with the wetlands and stuff and all their stormwater.
Yeah.
Okay. I did notice that the bylaw language for this, actually this, this
you
is
the regulation language?
I'm sorry, this is the regulation from him, and this is the
yes.
Bylaw language. He's using the words public services department again.
Is it? And where is that, Nick?
Page 3.
No, here.
Oh, okay. So it's...
And actually, he has the same comment about planning division in the first one. So let's just make that all consistent.
Mm-hmm.
So actually, the check would be written to the town of Reading, right? You should probably provide a check an amount. Oh no, they're providing it to. Okay, so then we would change this to the planning department. On page 3, planning division. Sorry.
Yep.
Okay. Okay. So it's in a couple places on that page. And what was your other comment, Nick?
That was it. It was that and the fees. So what are your thoughts on this? Do you think you want to keep looking at these? Do you want to approve one, not the other, or approve both?
I've reviewed them enough.
Yeah.
I guess. I don't see anything else that I...
I don't see any...
Additional time would give me any more clarity.
Yeah. I see no reason to not approve both.
I agree. Okay. So was this a public hearing?
It doesn't have to be.
Okay. Can I get a motion on both of these?
Before you
before that, and I know this is actually in the bylaw, so, but this is just more of a question. We have in here site plan containing the following information, stamped by Massachusetts PE or certified professional in ESC.
Erosion and sediment control.
What?
Erosion and sedimentation or sediment control.
Right.
So that's in the bylaw.
I've never heard that term before.
SESC, have you ever heard that one? Soil erosion and sediment control.
But not a certified per.
Oh, like in that.
Yeah, in that context.
That's a really good point, and I took that right out of the bylaw.
I know, I saw it in the bylaw. I remember at one point of thinking, what is that? And then, I don't know.
Well, I'll talk to Ryan about that and see if that exists, if he's ever seen that, because that's a very interesting point.
Okay, so now I've lost track of where we're at. Do we want the final version?
Do we need to hold off because of that on this particular piece?
No, because that's actually in the bylaw.
It's in the bylaw, right.
So we can have it in the checklist, as we should, but...
We'll just have to figure out what that means.
Yeah.
Okay.
Probably mostly we'll just see like PEs.
Yeah.
So the general bylaw, I mean, are there edits here that we are empowered to change, or?
Well, this isn't the general bylaw.
Changing the general bylaw.
This,
okay.
it says it's the general bylaw, but it's our procedures.
Right, pursuant to the general bylaw.
Yes.
Yeah, no, we can't change bylaws.
These are our procedures.
Meetings like this.
It's procedures, this is what she's gonna give out to people and the checklist.
Can we change the title of this now?
So maybe I should change it to say procedures pursuant to, so it's clear.
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
And then I'll do that for site plan as well.
So I'm not sure I know how to word a motion.
Well, we would adopt these. And I guess they're as amended because we've made some changes with the title, right? Title on the one and planning division on the other.
Okay. Move that the CPDC adopt the procedures for stormwater management and erosion control enforcement as amended.
Second.
All in favor? 3-0.
Do we need separate?
Does that cover them both, or do we have to do each one?
Do the regulations too.
Move that the CPDC approve the proposed regulations for CPDC administration of stormwater management and erosion control regulations as amended.
Second.
All in favor? 3-0. Town meeting presentation.
I think I forgot to bring it, actually. Hold on. Let me just go grab it off my desktop.
So is it going to be all me?
It doesn't have to be, because as a board member, I can make presentations.
Oh, and I misspoke. Miss emailed when I said town council would do the the recreational marijuana ones. So it's either gonna be you guys or someone from town staff, such as the town manager, so. And then town council's there to answer questions. So I'll let you mold that over and I'll go get the presentation.
Put on Bob. Let's make Bob do it.
He said he's happy to do it if you give him enough notice.
Actually, I'm not quite sure what the procedures are for speaking when you're not a town meeting member, but you are a member of the board.
I think that you just, or Jean would just need to let the moderator know, and then the moderator. Ask whether it's okay or invites you. Because I did the same thing at one.
Well, we've got, I mean, the finance board and all the other.
Yeah.
You can make a presentation.
Yeah.
You can,
Well, we can't vote because.
You can't vote, that's all.
Neither one of us got.
I guess you could answer questions. What do you think? You know the rules there?
I'm not certain of the rules, Mr. Chairman. However, I have seen people who are not even citizens of the town, i.e. members of, say, the RMLD or the school committee, not school committee, but the school department, actually get up and do a presentation. There would be no problem, as far as I'm aware, of a board member doing a presentation answering questions, but as you said, they would not be allowed to vote.
Right.
Or present their opinion. You have to be very careful on that.
Yeah. See, I was going to ask Alan, the moderator, about
mm-hmm.
that. You know, what is it that you're allowed to say or do?
Question.
They would be representative of the board only.
Right.
So many times I've seen Mr. Tuttle get up and say, not as a member of the CDBC, but as an individual citizen.
Right. Well, somebody has to be able to report on the CPDC action.
Correct.
If the CPDC took a vote to recommend blah, 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 that's something that can be reported.
You're going to go.
Yeah.
So if we had to, we could change it up right there.
Yeah.
See, so you get the cards.
No problems. Yeah, I think the presentations and all are no problem. I think it's probably the when it gets into discussion or Q&A. You might get into a position where you're answering questions or, like you said, giving opinions with the hat on as a town meeting member because you're used to doing that.
Yeah, and people have seen me as a team. Town meeting member, so they might still think I am a town meeting member,
right?
And think that I'm speaking as a town meeting member.
Yeah.
But as a member of the board, you would still be able to answer on behalf of the board. If the board feels X instead of Y, you certainly can say that. You just have to not vote.
Right.
So, you make any big decisions while I was gone?
No.
You should do the most difficult.
Sounds good.
I've written it so that it's all alliteration all the way through.
I think accessory apartments is going to be the most difficult one.
Sure.
Like from an explaining it and all the nuance and all the potential scenarios that people are going to throw at us about, you know, the carriage house that's 5 feet in the no build area, but, you know, or whatever.
3,000 feet behind it.
Right.
Compared to a stable barn, which by definition is 100 years old, right? We're not going to move it anywhere.
So, should I just go through? This part hasn't changed since the first time I showed it to you guys, but what I have changed is I added in stuff for marijuana. So I'll just go to that, I guess. Unless you want to.
Well, we can talk about this
because
David wasn't at the meeting yesterday.
Oh, yeah, right. So, when a couple members of the zoning board saw that we were switching the special permit granting authority for detached accessory apartments from their jurisdiction to you guys. They were like wondering why and what the background of that, like how that came to be. And we're thinking that either it should revert back to them to be consistent so everything's with them, or everything should be moved to you. So it's not...
Well, can I... that was their opinion, that everything should be with one.
Right, that was the opinion of a couple zoning board members.
For clarity and consistency.
For clarity and consistency, when dealing with accessory, accessory uses, that all the permitting should, all the special permits should go through the same, whether it's attached or detached. We discussed the differences where, you know, site plan review and versus modifications to an existing building, and you know, they still felt fairly strongly that it made sense to, for consistency's sake, to keep it all in one court. So
what section are we talking about here? This is 5.2.
And 5.4.7 actually is the accessory apartment section with the performance standards. But, right.
Because I'm trying to, according to the table, the Zoning Board of Appeals has the preservation issues. And the detached within an existing single family dwelling. And then new construction.
Well, if you look at the edits, we didn't have any of them.
No.
And during our discussions, we felt that certain ones were more of almost a site plan review issues, and so we brought them over to our side.
Right.
Now, we sort of agreed with them that it probably is best, probably is better if it all went to one of the boards, because it would just be more consistent that way. But Jen and I both agreed that it didn't make sense for all of them to be on our table because, for example, the preservation ones, some of those get into some pretty tricky legal stuff, and that's not what we're supposed to be doing. And so if it is going to be on one board versus the other, it made sense to give it back to Board of Appeals.
Right, and from a Four Corners of Town meeting standpoint.
Right. We felt that reverting the ones that we've edited, that the moderator would be in favor of that. So that they could make an amendment on the floor to edit those back.
Okay, so but what are the, I mean, the result of it is basically an accessory apartment in S15, 20, or 40 requires ZBA, is the way the table reads in the active bylaw.
Yeah, and then it would, right.
And that would be the same.
Always a special permit, right?
Unless there's no addition to gross floor area. Then they just have to meet the performance standards.
Right.
And satisfy the building inspector.
Right, and that's the least impact.
Right.
Okay. I mean, I have no objection to one way or the other. I'm just confused looking at the current state of affairs.
to look at the proposed state of affairs, and then maybe it'll make more sense.
These tables make a lot of sense here. You can clearly see what's happening.
Right.
If you look at the new tables.
Yeah, that, it's very, I think, very confusing, existing bylaw, but, there's all different types of accessory apartments, but then it's this part we're talking about, Dave. So this was with this zoning board, and we proposed to have it moved to you guys. And they were talking about making a motion on the floor of town meeting to actually just have it stay with them and have all of the special permits for accessory apartments stay with them.
Okay. There is a question about whether that fits within the article, because although one of them is reverting back,
one
is new.
Yeah.
Where it was not allowed, and now under this article is being allowed only as a special permit through CPDC. So it's not, wouldn't revert to anything that would be a change.
Right. So then Dave was going to follow up with Alan.
Right. But the intent was that there be some sort of review process that catches any problems with the proposal. And either way, that happens.
Yes.
Right.
Yep.
So
exactly.
Hopefully if they frame it that way, then the moderator sees it as being the intent. That's the intent of the bylaw.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Hopefully it's not a big deal.
Well, the changing is which board it goes to.
Yeah. Can we just keep scrolling through it?
Okay.
Okay.
So John's doing that one?
Sure.
Okay.
Perfect.
I mean, I can go through it here, or you guys can just look at it and tell me. Or, and I can send you the PowerPoint and you can change it yourselves to meet your presentation style if you think that's better.
Well, do we want to divvy them up right now?
Right, yeah. So I'll just keep scrolling through, I guess. This is all taken right from the warrant. All the stuff that's in here.
You want to do this one? Do you want me to do this one?
I don't doesn't matter to me.
I feel like I can just I can already hear the questions that are gonna be asked about this one. Anyway. So then we have Article 20, which is the prohibition of commercial marijuana establishments. Article 21, which is the temporary moratorium on commercial marijuana establishments. And Article 22, which is the home rule petition, which would basically ratify the prohibition if it passes. So then I did a little background. Should I zoom in, or is this good? Is it big enough?
Yeah, zoom in a little bit.
Just one, yeah.
Okay.
See the last icon on your toolbar, top?
This one?
Yeah. Click that. There you go. That's more of a presentation.
Oh, yeah. Good.
Okay, so the net result of our April 4th town election. Now, we abandon Articles 20 and 21 and we enact 22?
No.
Did I get those numbers
wrong?
I think you're getting to that, right? Or are you?
We're going
to
bring up a vote.
20 is the prohibition, 21 is the moratorium, 22 is the home rule petition. So the vote approved the prohibition. So the prohibition article in order to get language in the zoning bylaw is still on the warrant. And if that passes, then the moratorium will be tabled.
Okay.
21 will be tabled.
And the 22 is home rule?
And then 22, so if 20 passes, then 22 will be, will be voted on. So that's on the next slide, actually. Should I scroll down to that? Okay.
Wait, can you go back, I'm sorry, one, back to the, April 4th, Reading voters approved, is that the right terminology? Approved prohibition on commercial marijuana sales.
When you read it that way, it sounds funny.
Is that what was, I forget exactly. Did
voted
they?
In favor.
It was like a yes or no question, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like, should the town prohibit commercial marijuana establishments? And actually, the word commercial is only used because that's how it is in the warrant, in the table of contents. It's been called recreational. It's just been called marijuana establishments, not including medical marijuana dispensaries. It's been called so many different things that I was trying to just keep this consistent with what people are going to have in front of them at town meeting.
I know this is done through zoning, right? But this is a bigger question than zoning. I'm just wondering whether this needs to be presented by, I thought it made sense when Ray was going to present it. I'm just wondering whether this is the town manager's thing. It's sort of a town policy thing.
Yeah, it's, so I was informed that town council never presents articles. So that was never on the table. I just misunderstood. But Bob is happy to do it if you think it's better for him to do this. And he's been involved in all the nuance and all the back and forth with town council and attorney general, and he was involved in, creating the ballot question, and so he's happy to do this if you think that's...
Yeah, I mean, I don't have a problem doing it, but it really isn't. It's, zoning is the tool. It's not the...
Right.
The issue here.
Right, exactly.
It's just the tool that's being used. It's not a CPDC led.
No,
thing.
This, right, it's not.
Right? I mean,
right.
The questions that are going to come up are going to mostly be about attorney general discussions about legal things. So,
right.
You know, are you going to have two people getting up and down to talk, Ray and Bob? Are you going to have three people getting up and down to talk every time a zoning person standing up? You know, if it's one
I definitely agree that the only reason this is a zoning bylaw amendment is so that we have language in the bylaw. It's not
right.
Because, you know,
it's
a zoning issue, really.
Right.
I'm sorry, I backed up to this because I just think approved is not the right word.
You're right, it's not the right word.
They didn't, because if they approved a prohibition, done, they approved it, done.
Voted, as Dave said,
well,
in favor of prohibition, or voted in favor of the question?
Yeah, I mean, so if Bob's going to present this, he's going to change this.
Yep.
So.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, he already has it, and he's looked at it, and he just said, let me know.
All right.
So, probably don't need to
But if you can go...
But yeah, I'll go
through
it.
Yeah, just go through
for
it.
You.
Cannot sweat the details.
And then, so this is what, this sort of explains what needs to happen at town meeting.
Perhaps what we need to do is update the title of Article 20. Because it's basically...
It matches what's in the warrant.
Oh, okay.
Yes, the language has changed so many times. But.
Okay. I mean, it's... I was actually a little
makes sense.
Yep.
I was disappointed the town wrote it that way, but.
Actually go into like the meat of each article. And yeah, I'm not consistent. I realize I should be more consistent with my titles, but I just, it's hard to, it's just change, there's just so many different names this has been called. So anyway, this is the meat of the articles. And I will let Bob know that you'd like him to present it, and then he'll change it all, so.
Okay.
And then we come to, back to real, CPDC topics. Downtown Smart Growth District. It's pretty straightforward, the actual presentation, but the questions, I'm assuming, won't be, so.
Okay, so now this, this is a change to the language.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's the separate question is the expansion.
Is the map amendment.
The map change.
Right.
So just format wise, that first one, the accessory apartment one,
mm-hmm.
Where you lead off with what we're doing, like the why and
mm-hmm.
the
why changed?
Yeah, what is it? Why is it
keep
changed?
That in this.
I think that
yeah,
that
okay.
format helps sort of set the table.
Okay, sure.
Yep.
So we really have two issues. We've got accessory apartments, and we've got the smart growth. It's three questions.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So just pick whichever one you want to do, and I'll do the others, because I'm comfortable with either of them.
I'll do the smart growth one.
Do you want to do one?
Not particularly.
Are you even going?
Hmm?
Are you going?
You're a town, you're not a town meeting member anymore, are you?
I don't know yet. I probably
show your support, Dave.
I mean, you could attend as an opening, but didn't look like it.
I will usually show up for the night when the articles show up.
Oh, yeah, what night is that? Do we know?
Oh, sorry. So we're gonna have everything ready for the first night, just in case things go quicker. But they're thinking it will happen on the second night, so on Thursday, next Thursday.
Okay.
But be there on Monday, just in case.
Sure. Okay.
So for the first Monday, I probably will not be there, since it happens to be the last night of the Reading Men's Candlepin Bowling League.
Where do you guys bowl?
Woburn Bowlodrome.
Oh, okay.
You say it's not even in Reading, right?
Yeah, I was like,
well,
do we have a bowling alley?
I mean, we used to go to Candlewood Lanes up in North Reading, but they went the way of all things.
Okay, so so John, you're gonna take the 40R articles.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So should I do the why change thing for the map amendment as well? You did the background.
Well, I mean, we could come up with that, or we could look at that as well.
I feel like that's like a bigger. I put the background in here, which is kind of like the why changed.
Yeah.
And I don't.
Well, this doesn't really tell you which article this is.
It's missing its heading.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And is it grammatically better to say 12 units or fewer?
No, because it's. Well, project for 12 units or. Yes, that's correct. Yeah. didn't know if that maybe came right, because that isn't correct grammar, and that would be something I normally wouldn't do, but it might have come right out of the 40R statute. But I can change it. You good?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Guys wanna do the minutes?
Yeah.
Alright.
So, March 27th. I did not have any edits to March 22nd, 30, March 27th.
Move that the CPDC approve the minutes for the meeting of March 27th, 2017, as presented.
Second.
All in favor? Okay, so now we have April 3rd. I knew I had a couple, and I didn't send them to you because they were so minor. I was just going to give them to you tonight.
Okay.
It's fine. Oh, so bottom of page 3, it says, he said the homes will have dry wells, and I'm pretty sure that was to collect roof runoff.
Where did I say this?
Yeah, it's the very bottom of page 3, the last sentence.
Oh, yeah.
So the dry wells were there for the roof runoff.
Right. Okay, so should I just add that?
I think so.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Because he's draining the rest of the site using impervious pavement and all that. Another edit was, might be the bottom of page 4, let's see. I can't find the other one, but it was more of a, it was like a two to a four. Two, you know, two this, four this. It's not significant.
Okay, John?
Yep.
Move that the CPDC approve the minutes for the meeting of April 3rd, 2017, as amended.
Wait, what'd you say for date?
Third.
Did you say April 3rd? I'm sorry. Okay.
Second.
All in favor? Okay. Other business? Update on visioning work group progress?
That's being tabled for now. The after town meeting.
Okay.
What's going on? Jean and I are giving a presentation to the, and Andrew and Jesse are giving a presentation to the Board of Selectmen tomorrow night regarding economic development and planning, ongoing planning initiatives and projects, and 40Bs and a little bit of everything.
Okay, so our next meeting is the 22nd, is that correct?
The next, yeah, CPDC.
May 22nd?
May 22nd. May 8th was canceled.
How many nights are set aside for town meeting? Did they hold four?
I think it's four, yeah. Caitlin, do you know, is that correct?
I believe it was four, yeah.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Great, thanks.